As we get into the Word this morning, this is the second part of Acts chapter 10. If you need a Bible to follow along, we're going to be looking at verses 17 through 33. If you need a Bible, you can raise your hand and one of the ushers will bring you one marked to Acts chapter 10, verse 17 for you this morning. As we study the history of the church from the book of Acts, we realize that as we reach chapter 10, a significant change takes place through the ministry of the Apostle Paul, as he has shown a vision from Jesus that helps him understand how to overcome the religious boundaries he had grown up with as a child that would keep him from close contact with non-Jewish people called Gentiles. I imagine most of us here today are Gentiles, non-Jewish people, and Acts chapter 10 is for us. It brought the Gentiles into the church by the power of God. As Peter begins to see that these walls from his culture and his society and his religion would hinder God from bringing the gospel of Christ to all people, just as Jesus had commanded them almost 10 years prior to this, when he rose from the grave, he ascended to heaven, but as of yet, the gospel was only taken as a whole to the Jewish people in that immediate region, primarily because of these religious and social prejudices that were so ingrained, it would take an act of God to overcome. And that's exactly what God does. First, God sends an angel to a Roman captain in Caesarea, Cornelius, a man that was looking for God, a man that knew there was a God in heaven, but was so dismayed by the Roman pantheon, the Roman gods. And he knew this couldn't be God, and he began to seek God as he came to Israel and saw them worshiping the God of the Bible, and he knew that this had to be God. And then God gives Peter this vision of a sheet descending from the sky with all kinds of animals and commands Peter to kill and eat, to which Peter responds, "No way, I've never eaten anything unclean or common," to which the Lord replies in a matter-of-fact way, "Peter, do not call common or unclean that which I have cleansed." And of course, by now we realize this all pointed to the work of the cross to cleanse and make clean and holy to God all mankind that would come to God through the gospel of Christ. And in this we see a progression of events that shows us it can take time for those walls to come down, for things to change inside of us. And only God can do it. That's the catch. Only God can do it. So after Peter sees the vision, which we are told three times, so that he knew and he was certain this had come from God, the men that Cornelius had sent from Caesarea, from our last study, now arrive where Peter is in Joppa, as we read from verse 17 in Acts chapter 10. Now while Peter wondered within himself what this vision which he had seen meant, behold, the men who had been sent from Cornelius had made inquiry for Simon's house and stood before the gate or outside, and they called and asked whether Simon, whose surname was Peter, was lodging there. And while Peter thought about the vision, the Spirit said to him, behold, three men are seeking you. Arise, therefore, go down and go with them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them. Then Peter went down to the men who had been sent to him from Cornelius and said, yes, I am he whom you seek. For what reason have you come? And they said, Cornelius, the centurion, a just man, one who fears God and has a good reputation among all the nation of the Jews, was divinely instructed by a holy angel to summon you to his house and to hear words from you. Then Peter invited them in and lodged them. And on the next day, Peter went away with them, and some brethren from Joppa accompanied him. At this point, we realize our gracious Heavenly Father knows how difficult it is for us to overcome certain personal bias and prejudice deep within who we are before we come to Christ. And as Peter thought about the vision, he no doubt reasoned, God has cleansed all kinds of food for me to eat as a believer in Jesus, and there are no more restrictions under that old way of life. But why? What does it all mean? And as he wondered, the men Cornelius had sent stood at the gate or outside of the house and inquired if Peter was there. They knew that they couldn't just enter the house of a Jewish person, that it was against their customs. And so they respected that and inquired outside. Then we are told the Holy Spirit spoke to Peter, probably in a thought-like way in his mind, and said, there are three men here to meet you. Go down to them, doubting nothing, for I have sent them to you. I think this is very significant because God is still confirming to Peter, who is unsure about all of this. And the same will take place in our life as God brings us to new places. He will confirm those places through his word and by the Holy Spirit. I experience the Holy Spirit speaking to me on a pretty regular basis, and I'm always a little unsure, so I want to make sure that where I am and where I'm going lines up with what the Bible shows me in context of what God is doing. I think that's very important for Christians. I've known a lot of Christians that have been doing things and they said, well, God told me to do it. I'm like, wait, does that line up with God's word? Well, no, but I'm different. I'm like, whoa, you're not different. We're all the same, and we're God's children, and he does want to lead us by the Spirit, but it needs to line up with the word. How did it line up with Peter? Remember, Jesus told those apostles, I want you to go out into all of the world. And I want you to teach all of the world, including the Gentiles, what I have taught you. So this would line up with Jesus, the Word of God, right? This is very important. And the fact that Peter could hear and discern and recognize this was the voice of the Holy Spirit. As he relayed this story to Luke, who recorded it, Peter would say, and then the Spirit spoke. How did you know it was the Holy Spirit? Well, I know, because I can recognize his voice. And it lined up with everything that God was showing me. And in my flesh, I don't want to be around non-Jewish people. They have cooties. So You know, I'm sure he felt this way because of his culture and the way he was raised. So in this place, God confirms it through the Holy Spirit, and he'll do the same thing with you. If you will seek the Lord, and you will pray, and look at God's Word, and listen to His voice, and then if you're unsure, we have church leadership that prays with you, guys that study the Bible all the time, and we'll be able to show you that's really not lining up with what God does. And if God isn't confirming something, He wants you to wait. Cornelius had been waiting. We don't know for how long, but he had been waiting, and he's still waiting. So in this place, Peter understands this whole thing is from God. He's sure of that, right? He's shown three times the vision. Peter's kind of a three-time guy, you know what I mean? Jesus had to tell him three times. And then, you know, I think a lot of us are the same way. And I like the fact that Jesus will do that with us. That he's not all up in himself. And he's not like, I told you once and that's all you get. That's what my dad would be like. But Jesus isn't like my dad. Sorry, Dad. He will tell us as many times as we need to know to be confirmed or solid in the Spirit directing us. And then the Spirit tells him, don't doubt anything. I have sent them to you. And then Peter has to employ a humble heart to get over whatever he has to get over to go talk to these Gentiles. To respond then in a step of faith, which seems to be how God desires to install these system upgrades. Have you ever had a computer? You have to install a system upgrade? My phone told me yesterday it was installing a system upgrade, so I told God, I need a system upgrade. And he's like, well, then go get in the Word. Why are you so upset? Go get in the Word. And so we can get a system upgrade every day, but we also need to have a humble heart that will respond in action, in faith, to do what he said. Not just know what he has said, but to do it, and it has to be done in faith. Because whatever is not of faith, Romans 10 says, is of sin. Because we're doing it in our own strength and understanding. It's missing the mark. God wants us in a place of faith because it requires a humble heart. And when we respond in faith, this is the only pure modem or venue we can respond to God in, because, quite frankly, we're corrupted. We have corrupted files, we have corrupted software and hardware. Well, our hardware was upgraded through the cross, but our software, the way we do things, is really corrupted. So we need to walk in faith, and that's why. We see how the Lord, by the Holy Spirit, confirmed all of this with Peter. Verse 21, as Peter said to the men, he was who they were looking for. He asked them why they have come, showing Peter is still in a place where he can't understand all of it, but he's walking by faith and obedience to the Spirit. And this reveals this progression in Peter's transformation, in Peter's understanding. First, the message or the vision. Then the Spirit confirming he sent these men, which Peter could see were two Gentiles and a Roman soldier. Eek! For a Jewish guy, this would not be good. And Peter responds by asking them what they want. So he's in a humble place. The walls are coming down, aren't they? Through humility, the leading of the Holy Spirit. Then they tell Peter of Cornelius, the centurion from Caesarea, this God-fearing man that helps the Jewish people there. And he was instructed by an angel of God to send for Peter and to hear what Peter has to tell him. It's very possible that at this moment, Peter is beginning to put two and two together, because we are told he then invites them into the house and lodged them overnight. That's a big step. Not only two Gentiles, but a Roman soldier. This has quite a dynamic behind it. Peter is now beginning to yield these things to God. And he really, I don't think, understands all of it, but it's now beginning to come together. We see this progression. First, we see Peter staying with a tanner as we start chapter 10, which the Jewish law says he's not supposed to do. And then we see that Peter has a vision that God really changes the Jewish regulations concerning dietary laws. Then the Spirit tells him that he has sent these Gentiles to him. That Roman soldier, those two Gentiles, I sent them to you. And now he invites them in, which is also against the Jewish law, but more of the traditions of the Jewish laws. The original law of Moses was simply to keep the Jewish people separate from the pagan society, in a sense. And in that place, it wouldn't allow the Jewish people to intermarry with non-Jewish people. It wouldn't allow them to worship their pagan gods. It wouldn't allow them, and many times that involved food, so they wouldn't eat with them. It meant keeping the Sabbath law of God, the circumcision and dietary laws, which would naturally keep the Jewish people separate in many, many ways from their societies. So it really wasn't about God not accepting the people. And I think at this point, Peter is really starting to understand it wasn't about the Gentiles not being accepted by God, but what the Gentiles did that separated them from God. And that fits the context of what we see in the Bible. So we understand this truth. It wasn't that God was rejecting the people. The people were rejecting God through their pagan lives, and they had that testimony in them that what they followed wasn't the truth, like Cornelius. That's why he was crying out to God. So from our perspective, we know that when a person comes to Christ, they experience being born again by believing in Jesus. They are led into an entirely new dimension of life, the life of the Spirit of God, in a sense being set apart, or the word is holy from the Bible, to live for God. And in that place, the Spirit of God is now leading and teaching and redirecting and comforting and assuring, because of all the hang-ups we have before we come to Christ. The places where we grew up, all of the religious stuff we may have been raised with. I think religion is the bane of America because they've become religious instead of God-fearing people, instead of people that have a relationship with Jesus. And all religion does is cause problems, which we see. I think we have such an advantage over the early Christians in this day and age, mainly because we have what is called the canon of Scripture, or the written word of God that we can verify has come from God through the fulfilled prophecies. And what an advantage indeed. I think sometimes we lose, you know, how much of an advantage we have in this day and age to know we have an accurate copy of the Scriptures and the Holy Spirit and the work of God through the church. What an advantage. I think it's so unfortunate that many Christians, in my opinion, don't take advantage of understanding we have the living Word of God in our midst today. We don't need a prophet to come along. We don't need preachers to tell us new things about God. We just need preachers that will tell us what God has said and do it in an accurate way. And that's our greatest desire, is not to teach people anything about God, but simply declare what God has said. And He said a lot. And it does take study, and that's why we need pastors in our church to study the Word and to declare what God has said in an accurate, non-religious way. But how unfortunate. Most Christians today really just do what they think is right, and they try to do the best they can, I think, And for the most part, they miss the power of the Word of God in their lives. It's kind of like at the time of the judges in the history of Israel. Everybody just did what was right in their own eyes. And if you study the book of Judges, you think, what a mess. They had the tabernacle from Moses at Shiloh, and they were doing what? They were doing what they thought was right in their own minds. It was a mess, and that describes our society today. You might be one of those unfortunate folks today, and if so, that can be corrected as we begin to pray daily that God gives us a desire and a hunger for His Word. God can do that. I know He did that in my life. As a new Christian, I'd read the Bible, and I knew it was God's Word, and I was seeing some things, but as I got into the study of doctrine and theology, I was so lost, and I said, God, You've got to give me a hunger and a desire for Your Word, and He did. Within a year period of time, I would be at every Bible study, every discipleship group I could find, and I still am. Because I'm learning every time I'm with the body of Christ because of the Holy Spirit and the Word of God. I'm still growing in Christ. The next day, Peter went with them to Caesarea. Notice, he took some brethren or fellow believers in Jesus. As chapter 11 tells us, he took six other men with him. As it's thought that Peter knew he would run into issues with the Jewish believers back in Jerusalem, which he would in chapter 11. And he took the other believers as witnesses, which shows great wisdom and discernment, I think, from God. Just as God promises us wisdom to those who ask for it and believe that God will give it to us from James chapter 1. Did you know that promise was in the Bible? That you have to believe it. I'm going to ask for wisdom, and I'm going to believe that God is going to give it. So we're going to pray, and we're going to ask, and we're going to wait, because God is going to hear our prayer. God is going to give us wisdom. And if I need to move out and take care of something, I know that God is going to be with me because the Bible says so. What a confidence we can have in life. I find the times that I mess things up the most is because I'm either getting prideful or I'm getting prideful. And I don't pray. And I think, I can do this, whatever. And I'm not staying close to Him and listening to Him. So in verse 24, the following day, they entered Caesarea, and Cornelius was waiting for them and had called together his relatives and close friends. As Peter was coming in, Cornelius met him and fell down at his feet and worshipped him in verse 25 there. But Peter lifted him up, saying, "Stand up, I myself am also a man." And as he talked with him, he went in and found many who had come together. Then he said to them, "You know how unlawful it is for a Jewish man to keep company with or to go to one of another nation, but God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I came without objection as soon as I was sent for. I asked then, for what reason have you sent me?" Wow. Cornelius, this Roman officer, a centurion, he was waiting for Peter. He had invited his friends, his close family, relatives. He was convinced that God had heard his prayer. And he took action because he was convinced, which speaks of a faith that takes action. That's the kind of faith we need. A faith that takes action or has a real response because of a real belief. A belief that God is real and that God has heard our prayer. Where else can we find that kind of dynamic in life? God is real and He will hear my prayer. And I'm going to continue to pray like Cornelius because God is going to hear my prayer. I believe it. And I'm going to take action in my life based on that. And certainly Cornelius, we know that he had not found that in the worship of the pagan gods of Rome, and neither will we. No, our idols cannot love us back. They will not answer the deepest prayer of our hearts, and they will only satisfy for a short time, unless we see things for what they are, the things that God allows us to use in life. I have a theory that we don't own anything material because it wears out. It's under the atrophy of destruction. We just use it for a while. We try to use it the best way we can. Some of those things God allows us to use for our basic needs. Some of those things God allows us to use for our comfort, even for our pleasure. The Bible tells us that. And some of those things we use for the furtherance of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And hopefully it's all under the direction of God and not our own wisdom and understanding that is so controlled by that old nature called the flesh. It's the human nature in us. We still have it. Yes, we're born again. We are assured of eternal life in Christ, but we still have that old nature that influences us tremendously. We're influenced by this fallen world system we live in that influences our flesh. We're influenced through demonic messages that influence our flesh. And man, we need the Word of God and the Holy Spirit and the church big time in order to see all of it. I don't think Cornelius had ever experienced a prayer being answered. And he knew this one would be. So as Peter arrives, comes in, he falls down before Peter. And it's just such a tender moment, I think. He comes into the house of not only a Gentile, but a Roman soldier. The Romans were hated by the Jews. They were occupying force there in Israel for 100 years. They had pridefully exercised authority over the Jews in every aspect of their life. I don't think we could know how difficult that would be to overcome emotionally. Man, there's Peter. He walks into that place because he knows this is what God has said to do. And as he enters, Cornelius falls at his feet and worships him, probably thinking Peter is some kind of Christian celebrity that needed to be bowed down to, which was really a part of the Roman culture that he was familiar with. And I think we see that in our culture, our societies today. We are such a celebrity, influence-driven society, even in the church. Oh, we've got this certain speaker coming in, you know, and he's this guy. Or we've got this certain worship leader coming in. He's this guy. It's a celebrity platform, which is not all bad. But we have to be careful of our flesh in that place, or we can end up worshiping that celebrity instead of the God that he worships. We have to be careful in all of these things. And we see this in religion where you bow down and kiss somebody's ring or do whatever. And I'm thinking, whoa, read the book of Acts. Peter said, get up or don't do that. I myself am also a man. I think this was such a tender moment, a humble moment. Peter lifts him up with a kind spirit, I believe, and says, stand. I am also a man, and I say that because the language implies that I am a man like you. That's tender coming from Peter and coming from the walls that he had overcome just to be in that room. And he lifts him up and probably embraces him. I am a man like you. And as Peter goes in, he sees all these people gathered there. I presume it was a fairly large house with an inner Mediterranean open courtyard area, which was common in that era to the upper class. There could have been a couple of hundred people sitting there waiting for Peter. And Peter says in verse 28, you know how unlawful it is for me to be here, a Jew being with you, but God has shown me that I should not call any man common or unclean. Therefore, I came without objection as soon as I was sent for, but God has shown me. Man, we're going to get to places in our life where God has to show us things. And if we're not at those places, we need to ask ourselves, why? Am I doing this to God? Because God hasn't shown me anything lately. And we're in this continual progression, just like Peter, with even deeper seated emotional issues from our culture and our society that only God can deal with. Has God been showing us anything lately? Man, I think it's so important for us as we grow in Christ to say, oh man, God has been showing me what a jerk I am. And man, I'm so selfish and I want my own way all the time and so limited, and I limit myself and I'm like, I can't do that because of this and that. Man, God has shown me I'm my own worst enemy. Has that ever happened to you? Or is it just me? Come on, folks. Hell, it happened to me. Of course, you know what I'm talking about, right? I love it. Is it so well known to them that it would be unlawful for Peter to come? Can you imagine the conversations before he got there? He's not coming. Cornelius, I love you, man, but he's not coming. That guy is a Jew, and he's some kind of special guy, and he's not coming because you are a Roman. They hate you guys. Cornelius is like, God told me he's coming. Oh, Cornelius, it's okay. And that's what the world does to us, isn't it? Oh, it's okay. God knows. And because we've become anemic in our spiritual life, not believing God anymore. Peter makes it clear God has shown him that all mankind is accepted by God. So he comes, seeing now what the vision of the sheet of animals let down from the sky meant. I can imagine the look on his face as he looked around that room. He was like, I know what it means. He was probably seeing the sheet there and says, I know what it means. And Cornelius then answers Peter's question of why they sent for him. In verse 30 there, Cornelius says, I sent for you because 4 days ago I was fasting until this hour, and at the ninth hour, about 3 p.m., I prayed in my house, and behold, a man stood before me in bright clothing and said, Cornelius, your prayer has been heard, and your alms are remembered in the sight of God. Send therefore to Joppa and call Simon here, whose surname is Peter. He is lodging in the house of Simon, a tanner by the sea, and when he comes, he will speak to you. When he comes, I know he's coming, because God has said he's coming. He will speak to you. So I sent to you immediately, and you have done well to come. Therefore, we are all present before God to hear all the things God command, all the things commanded you by God. Let me read that one more time. So now, therefore, we are all present before God to hear all the things commanded you by God. That's what's called a preacher's dream. People gathered together, ready to hear from God, recognizing that God will send a messenger to them, a preacher like Peter. And as Cornelius tells Peter what happened, we notice he was in fasting and in prayer, as is very common throughout time for people to refrain for a time from food in a place of prayer as a sign to God that they were desperate to hear from God. I think people misconstrue a lot of this stuff with fasting. It's like they fast in order to try to get God to do something. And the place we see from the context in the word generally is that they are fasting so that they can hear from God. They want to know what it is God is doing. I think, you know, there's many people here at this church that practice regular times of fasting and prayer. And it's not because we are commanded by God to do so. I hate fasting. I'm going to just say it right out. But so does the devil. That's something God had shown me years ago. I don't know, it's probably Pastor Isaac said to me, "Man, I don't know why we're fasting. I just feel hungry all day." I'm like, "Well, Isaac, you know, it's a spiritual thing, man. We're doing this for spiritual reasons, and the devil hates it." I know the devil hates it because I get so attacked when I'm fasting. It's amazing. So in that place, we're not commanded by God to fast, are we? Does he command us anywhere to fast? We fast because we're desperate to hear from God, and that's the truth. We're not the deeply spiritual people you thought we were. We are deeply desperate people to hear from God every single day. We know how spiritually lame and deaf and blind, I shouldn't say we, I said I know how spiritually lame and deaf I am. I mean, I have a hard time hearing from God. My brain is just messed up and I have such a hard time. And I believe fasting, a regular time of fasting, gives us more sensitivity to the things of God than we would normally have without it. Remember, Jesus said, "My disciples do not fast now, but they will. They will. When I go to the Father." And I think he said that in a way, it's like he knew that when his physical presence ascended to the Father, now we interact with Jesus through the Holy Spirit, we're such fleshly beings. We're like, "Oh God, I can't hear from you. I'm going to spend time in fasting and in prayer because I see that's what these guys were doing. And they were able to hear from you." And the devil hates it. Did I mention that? So as God answers the prayer, it says, of Cornelius, we see from the whole context of this what that prayer was, don't we? He wanted to know God. He wanted to know the true living God that he knew existed deep inside, but he felt so separated from in his life. And the message, I think, is clear that God is real. And God has no problem communicating in ways that are real and affirm what we already know. We know it, don't we? God is real. He's just as real as anything we can imagine. But don't we struggle in that place to embrace that reality? And that's why fasting and in prayer is so important. And God answers that prayer. And it almost looks to me like when I study several of these cases in the Bible, that it appears God waits until a person is so desperate to hear from God, even desperate enough to just not even eat. They're just like, "God, if I don't hear from you, I'm not going to eat, and I'm going to pray and wait." And then we see God answer that prayer in a way that leaves no doubt. God is saying, "Yes, I know who you are, and I have heard your prayer." Think about these things. Remember Hannah in the Old Testament. She couldn't have a child. She was so desperate. They would go to the feast at Jerusalem and she would just sit before the altar. "God, please, if you don't give me a child, I'll die in this place." And God heard her prayer, right? She was so desperate. And over we see with Cornelius, "I know that you exist." And he was in a time of fasting and prayer. It almost implies that this was something that he was going through in his life, not just a one-time deal. And then God leads Cornelius and his family and his friends to this place where God reveals himself to them through the gospel of Jesus Christ. He reveals himself through the gospel of Jesus Christ, that God is answering that prayer. He's not giving Cornelius another God, another religion. He's giving him the truth of the gospel of Christ, which we will see next study. But the answer is that, yes, God exists and he loves you. He has loved us through the cross, and he is the answer to all our prayers. You know, I had a discussion with a demon-possessed person one time that told me, Satan loves us. And I said, well, just the opposite is true. Satan is letting you have some of these wicked things that you are desiring in your flesh, but he's enslaved you to accomplish his purpose, and then he will kill you in a torturous way, and he will lead you into an everlasting lake of fire. And then he said, well, God enslaves you. And I go, that's true, but he enslaves us through his love, through his kindness. And we find true freedom in that place of being enslaved to God. No longer slaves to ourselves and our own human passions and desires, but now free to live in the power of God in our lives. A supernatural power that gives us a sound mind in this ever-changing world, and a deep emotional security that's based in truth. The truth of who God is, what God has done through Christ. That's being solid in this day and age. And it's available to all who will call upon his name. And as Cornelius shares his testimony with Peter, Peter now knows why he's there. To preach Jesus Christ and him crucified and resurrected, ever living in glory at the right hand of the Father. And they are there and ready to hear the gospel of Christ, ready to receive the truth of God through this man, Peter, who was sent by God to preach the truth of God to them. I think this is an important concept to grasp at this place. When we gather together in the name of Jesus, are we ready to receive the things God delivers to us through the pulpit that's in this church? Or is there something else taking place in our hearts? Maybe something religious. Maybe something else. The Holy Spirit can reveal that to us in a loving, gentle way. We really recognize, especially with Calvary Chapel here in Payson, if you know the history of our church here, this is only taking place through a miracle of God. That this is happening because God was very specific in calling us to reopen this church that had been closed down and had suffered some tragic things that God had to heal and work through. I know that God has put this place here. And even through all the flaws and imperfections of the man giving the message, like Peter, like me, man has many imperfections. But man can also know and be confirmed by the Holy Spirit where to go and what to do and what to say. So it may do us good to ask when we are in church, why am I here? Is it to hear from God, or is it something else? And I believe the Holy Spirit, as I said, will help us to know those things, because some of those things are deep places of bias and prejudice and misunderstanding that we might have grown up with. Watch out for those preachers. All they want is your money. Have you ever heard that one? I was like, man, how come I didn't get the money? Today, I declare to you, as the man that God put in this pulpit, that Jesus wants to make us free. He wants to make us free from our traditional boundaries and self-imposed bondages, many times through our petty humanistic judgments and narrow-minded prejudice. Yeah, I just said that about you. I saw that one lady turn to her husband. Did he just call us idiots? This is the human problem, isn't it? It's the problem Peter had, isn't it? So then it's the problem we have, isn't it? That's us. That's who we are. But it's not who God wants us to be. God wants to change us. God wants to transform our lives. And he tells us so in his word. And in this place, we find a freedom from ourselves. A freedom. When Peter was standing there, he felt that freedom at that moment. And I'm sure he's thinking, this is not going to go good in Jerusalem. But these guys are going to get saved today. And we're going to watch him work through these things as we finish our study next week, Lord willing. And we realize this is the freedom that Jesus promised us. Freedom to love. Freedom to stand in the truth. Freedom to break every chain, every wall, every hindrance. To us knowing him like Cornelius. We're going to see some things about Cornelius next week that just struck me yesterday. And I was like, oh, goodness. Oh, wow. That's heavy. But he was free. He was finally free from Rome. He was free from himself. And like Peter and so many millions throughout time, everyday people like you and like me, like Cornelius, Peter, and all the folks that were gathered there that day, God promises us the same freedom and wants to do that work for us. So I want to close with the music ministers and this invitation that our hearts would be open to him, that our hearts would be open to the fact that he loves us, he sent his son for us, and that he wants to change us, to make us free. And if he wants to make us free, it's because he knows we're not. We're still bound up in self, like Peter. And he wants to give us an Acts chapter 10 moment. God has shown me how small I really am, how stubborn I've been with God. And that God is changing those things in my life. If you're here this morning and you've never received the truth of the gospel, you have not asked Jesus to be your Lord and your Savior, to give you eternal life, you can do that now as we stand together. You can do that today and say, Jesus, I want to believe in you. And if you were able to grasp what Peter was going through, you can say, God, that's me. That's me. That man right there, that's me. And I want to be free. I don't want to be controlled by all of those things in my life anymore. And God will hear your prayer. God will hear your prayer today. And he'll begin to work in your heart and maybe leading you by the Spirit to a place of fasting and in prayer, so that you can hear from God. We've become so dull, so spiritually thick. God, help us. We cry out, Holy Spirit, you see our hearts. Hear us, Lord.
Holy Spirit, would you come fill me up? Would you come inspire me?
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Would you come inspire me? I'm asking you to have grace inside my heart.
Jesus.
Jesus, you know what I need. So breathe in me.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Lord, we know that you see the cry of our heart as you saw the heart of Cornelius there so long ago. This man that was so desperate to know you. He would lay it all on the line to become a believer in Christ. God, that's what we want our lives to look like. Help us, Lord, because no one can do this but you. We can't do it ourselves. All we can do is recognize it. Say, Lord, I'm not there. As the Apostle Paul said from Philippians, I have not yet attained that for which he pursued my heart. God, may that be us in this place today as well. We'll be here to pray with you after the service. If you need prayer, pray for healing, anointed with oil. And think about these things today as we go back out into this world, this society. Think about a time of fasting and prayer and lift it up to God and ask him to help you with those things, because he wants to show us a lot of things. And maybe we can get the t-shirt that says, but God has shown me. Amen. Let's give him praise and glory this morning, Jesus. Amen, Jesus. We bless you, Lord. Amen.